Even though the course is a big book with 31 chapters and 365 lessons and a manual for teachers, you have to do one thing first before you can come to forgiveness or accept the course. So I'm going to tell you the one thing that you must do. You must do this before you're in a position to accept your divine innocence. You must do one thing. It doesn't matter if you write books on the course or you don't. It doesn't matter whether you have course groups or not, whether you speak or not. The course even says a teacher of God can heal the world without a sound. Your words, your sounds, and all the things that seem important, even in terms of the world with the course, are not important at all. But I will tell you, you must do this one thing first before you're in position to accept what divine innocence is and what forgiveness is. And the one thing, Francis and I were talking about this morning on our call, is you have to accept that you have a perceptual problem. You have to accept that you have a perceptual problem. You cannot accept the solution. You cannot accept the correction until you accept that you have a perceptual problem. And that was in even the opening song that Zach and Lilo were singing. There was a line in there about a new way of looking at the world. A new way of looking upon the world, it's not talking about through the body's eyes. It's not talking about a different, higher vantage point with the body's eyes or a different point of view, but it's talking about a different point of view in your mind. And you have to admit, first of all, that you have a perceptual problem or you won't be able to open to this new way. You will still see yourself as a person with all of the personal problems that seem to be part of the human condition. And we talked about a lot of them already this weekend. You can't admit that you have a perceptual problem and maintain that you have health issues, economic problems, that you have relationship issues, that you have issues with the environment, with temperature or pollution, that you have issues with governments and politicians. You can't have issues with children and with parents and with neighbors. You can't have issues with different cultures or societies. You know, you can't have issues with a mosquito and think that you have a perceptual problem. Because that issue with that mosquito, I tell you, is very arrogant. It's almost like saying the Holy Son of God can have the peace taken away by a mosquito. Something as tiny as a mosquito in this entire cosmos, and that's quite arrogant to believe that the Holy Son of God can be disturbed by a mosquito. And Frances, in her opening session, she was saying, really all Jesus was showing us with the Course was, you are asked to not perceive attack in much less extreme situation than what I went through. And she was saying, it's in her own life, there's been nobody dragging her, having her drag a big cross through the streets and put a crown of thorns on her head and throw some vinegar in her mouth and then spikes driven into her arms and legs, you know, and blood coming out for hours and hours. No, it's like all of us have got a much less extreme temptation to believe an attack than that scene. He was just demonstrating in the most extreme case, you can still be meek, you can still be defenseless, you can still be the Christ because you're not a body. You can still transcend and show that you are spirit in the most extreme situation that the ego can come up with. So let's go back to that mosquito. If you If you actually believe that there's anything in this world that can take your peace away, no matter how tiny that thing is, what that means is that you are not acknowledging that you have a perceptual problem. You are not acknowledging that the way that you're looking at the world is the problem. Once you say that mosquito out on the screen is upsetting you, you are not accepting your responsibility of seeing that everything is mind. Everything is a thought in the mind. And you can't possibly accept the correction if you have missed the problem. If you've misdefined the problem, even if the correction is there and available, you will not accept that correction. You can't even use it. It's almost like you've got this divine light that's there saying, I'm right here. And if you are misdefining yourself and the problems of this world, you will not be able to accept the correction. And as I read through all the beautiful questions that you've all written in, and as I listen to you speak, I can feel underneath it that there's like your heart is crying out and saying, please, what is the simple way that I slip past years of effort, that I slip past countless years, decades, centuries of effort? How can I slip past them and slide right in there to position of accepting the atonement? And that is very simple. You have to admit that you have a perceptual problem. Just like I think I saw Frank has joined us on here, and Frank's been part of the 12-step program. And in 12 steps, you have to come to an admission of your problem before you can begin the healing process. There's nobody that goes through the 12-step program who heals by remaining in a state of denial about what's going on. If they're denying their drinking or their addiction, or if they're denying their emotions, or maybe they're just denying the thoughts, and they just say, I have no problem, then the 12-step program says, well, actually, you're not going to heal until you first admit the problem. And in one sense, it's like that they're powerless over their addiction. They're powerless over their lives as they've perceived them. Jesus is asking us the same thing with the Course. He's saying, you have to admit that you're powerless over the way that this world seems to be. That what Francis was describing, a very vicious, hostile world of hatred that is the result of the ego. You have to admit that you've been mistaken in everything about this world. You cannot come to a solution until you can come to a very deep confession of I have a perceptual problem. And for some of you may say, okay, I can kind of follow that, David. You know, sentimentally I can follow it. But practically, if you knew my life situation, you know, it's like, wow, that can seem like a little airy-fairy, a little bit of like pixie dust or something. I go to my to deal with all this stack of bills, or I have a long-standing health issue, or I've got current relationships, grievances and everything, and it's almost like you're talking about this perceptual problem almost like it's pixie dust, and somehow I'm supposed to believe I'm in a fairy tale, and this little pixie dust is gonna Tinkerbell will just sprinkle some pixie dust and then I'm home free. And this is why I talked in depth about mind training. In other words, why do we practice the mind training? Why do we watch our minds so carefully? Why in community are we encouraging no private thoughts, no people pleasing? Are we encouraging everything to come up, everything to get exposed, every preconception to be exposed, every belief to be exposed, every single thought, every last shred of thinking to be exposed and brought to the light? Jesus says it's important. He says to learn this course requires willingness to question every value that you hold. Not one can be kept hidden, or it will jeopardize, it will delay your learning. So basically, I thought I would just do like Francis. I'm just going to read just a little bit from lesson 79, because this lesson right here, lesson 79 of the workbook, is going to be our springboard to a practical experience of what Francis said. Today is the day. If you can go with me and you can follow what I'm saying and what Jesus is saying in this lesson, this is like a huge time saver. This like that takes you in the tractor beam, and it just takes you so high. And if you can go with what is being shared in the beginning of this lesson, that you can literally be beamed up and lifted up. Your mind can be so lifted up by Jesus that you will be at the gates of heaven if you can follow this lesson. You will be transported, you know, like in Star Trek, the transporter room. You will be beamed and transported to the gates of heaven from wherever you seem to be in time and space in your awareness. But what Jesus is going to talk about in here is he's going to talk about what I'm mentioning about seeing that you have a perceptual problem, because until you have that admission, there is no chance of accepting forgiveness exactly as it is. It's still going to be a lot of game playing, a lot of distractions, and it's going to involve a lot of time, like spinning your wheels and going round and round and round in circles, really going nowhere if you are not able to join your mind with this. So let me just read through this, and then we'll launch into this together. This will be our trampoline today. This will be our rocket ship today. We're taking a rocket ship, and we actually are going on the rocket ship because we want to go on the rocket ship. We would have no more delay in accepting our true nature, our true identity. And that's the prayer, and this will be our rocket ship. Lesson 79, let me recognize the problem so it can be solved. A problem cannot be solved if you do not know what it is. Even if it is really solved already, you will still have the problem because you will not recognize that it has been solved. This is the situation of the world. The problem of separation, which is really the only problem, has already been solved. Yet the solution is not recognized because the problem is not recognized. Again, if I have economic issues, financial issues, I haven't recognized the problem. If I have relationship issues, grievances, hurts, pains about any relationship that comes to mind in this life or any lifetime, in past lives, in future lives, it doesn't matter. If I have relationship issues, I have not recognized the problem, that I have a perceptual problem. If I have health issues, if I have issues with the environment, I'm too hot, I'm too cold, I'm too hungry, I'm too thirsty, I don't feel comfortable, I feel anxious, or if I feel depressed or sad or nervous or I'm worrying, any of those things, it's simply one thing. I have not admitted the problem. I have not admitted that I have a perceptual problem. So he continues on. Everyone in this world seems to have his own special problems, yet they are all the same and must be recognized as one if the one solution that solves them all is to be accepted. Who can see that a problem has been solved if he thinks the problem is something else? Even if he is given the answer, he cannot see its relevance. So, Jesus at one point, he basically calls this world in his workbook a hallucination. At other times in the text, in the workbook, he calls it a dream. He calls it passing images. I mean, he has many different names for it, but if you are not willing to accept that you have a perceptual problem and that you are hallucinating, then you must believe that you're perceiving a real world with real issues and real things and real people and real everything, and you're not seeing this as a hallucination. It's seeing it as a reality. Again, even if you begin to start to see the power of your mind and you start to think and believe you have the power to create your own reality, to manifest your dreams, to manifest anything that you want, again, I say to you, what makes you think you know what you want? Even if you could manifest anything that you want, what makes you believe that you actually know what it is that you could manifest that would make you happy? And this, I know some of you have tried this. You're pretty good at this. So you're smiling and nodding like, yeah, I've done a pretty good job of manifesting, actually. Still not satisfied. But so if you start to realize that even the belief in manifesting still has underneath it some sense of lack in the present moment, and still manifesting always still looks to the future. Just like those that meditate for many hours looking for future release, maybe in a number of years or decades, it's still looking for future release, or maybe something that's attractive, manifesting a house or a car or a boat or a soulmate or whatever, manifesting astral travel to other dimensions, you know, on and on and on and on. That's still a denial of the perceptual problem. That's still not confessing that there's a perceptual problem going on. Even if you can astral project to different times and different realms and go visit Cleopatra in the past and go visit different saints in the future and everything, it's still not going to help you. You still got the same mosquito of a problem because it's still a time and space problem. You know, you may think that sounds kind of cool, but I'll tell you, it's not cool at all. This cosmos is made by a death wish. And as long as you keep playing around and trying to play around with the images, it just means that you want the death wish instead of the kingdom of heaven, instead of nirvana. So now he says, that is the position in which you find yourself now. You have the answer, but you are still uncertain about what the problem is. A long series of different problems seems to confront you, and as one is settled, the next one and the next arise. There seems to be no end to them. There is no time in which you feel completely free of problems and at peace. The temptation to regard problems as many is the temptation to keep the problem of separation unsolved. The world seems to present you with a vast number of problems, each requiring a different answer. This perception places you in a position in which your problem solving must be inadequate and failure is inevitable. Now, I don't know about you, but when I read this, I was just like, oh, hallelujah. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for giving it to me straight. You're not trying to sugarcoat this whole thing one bit. You're saying, I'm telling you right now, as long as you have thoughts and concepts in your mind and you think you can define your problems, that just means you think you can define your identity as an identity with problems. And he's basically saying that's really arrogant to think you can do that, because God created you perfect and innocent, and now you're trying to misdefine yourself, and you're so stubborn. You just want to keep at it for hundreds of years, thousands of years. Stubborn, won't come to that simple admission that I have a perceptual problem. That's what reincarnation is. Now, I know these always end up on Facebook the next day as a quote from David Hoffmeister, but reincarnation is the stubborn belief that you do not have a perceptual problem. That's what reincarnation comes from. It comes from the stubborn belief, I do not have a perceptual problem. And Jesus is saying, oh, yes, you do. And until you admit it, you're just going to keep spinning and spinning in time and space, like that old TV show back in the, I think it was in the 60s, Lost in Space. Danger, Will Robinson. Danger, sleeping son of God. Danger, sleeping son of God. Lost in space. Lost in time and space. That's it. It comes down to that. Now, I know a lot of you are probably thinking, I'm glad that you're being so direct with me here, and I'm glad Jesus is so direct, and I'm grateful for that, but there's a but. You have the finger going up, and you have a but. There's a but happening in your mind. And what the but is, it's like, oh, how this is always the question when Jesus gives you, it's so simple, just accept right now that you have a perceptual problem, and then you go, okay, Jesus, how? You know, you have to throw it off with the how question. It's just a single recognition, and you have to turn it into some kind of a big how. You have to turn it into some kind of big time process. And, you know, oh, okay, give me a technique, Jesus. Give me a good set of techniques for this, to recognize it's a perceptual problem. Give me a shortcut. Give me a code. Give me give me the secret. Give me the answer. Is this a riddle? Give it to me. And it's interesting because it's just a recognition that the way I've been looking at the world is wrong-minded. The way I have been looking at this world is mistaken. It's a goof. It's just a goof. It's an oops. Now, what do you want? You want a process to handle the oops? You know, don't make it so complicated. You know, an admission of a mistake is very, very, very simple. And when you avoid the admission, then you start to say, maybe I'm not so ready for this admission. What it's really saying is, maybe I like to dilly-dally and dingle-dangle in time a bit before I admit that I have a perceptual problem. You know, Jesus is like, you're free to do that. I'm here with you, and I'll stay with you to the end of time, and I won't leave you, but we're always going to come back to this point of this admission of a perceptual problem. We're always going to come right to this point. We can't go home until we get to this point together, until we see that it is so. Now, if you're watching this on your screen, on your Zoom screen, again, you may be thinking, well, maybe that's what worked for you, but But you may still think you've got a lot of real problems that you're dealing with, like real, real earthly time-space problems that if you don't deal with these problems, some of them you could die. It could be like a really bad outcome. Like if you don't deal with the problems that you've got in your life, you could just die. That seems like a pretty serious thing. And yet, what I'm saying is, why do you think we're doing this? Why have we joined for this weekend except to experience mastery through love, except to open, to come as close to eternity as we can, to come to the gates of heaven? And why am I talking about the Course and the passages from the Course and the books and the resources? Why do I talk about Spiri? Why do I talk about retreats? Why do I talk about community devotional stays? All I'm talking about is you have to at least give it over to the Spirit and say that my personal sense of trying to personally decide my way out of this world has not succeeded. My personal perspective, of trying to be in charge of my own awakening has failed. That's a good thing to start with. If I've tried personally to untangle myself from this world, I think you should start off with some honesty and say, I have not succeeded in untangling myself. I have put a lot of effort, perhaps, in, and I'm still as tangled as ever. And another thing you could say is, maybe I don't, as Francis was saying, you don't have to get so really intensely caught up into right and wrong in this world. I can't tell you how many people say, did I make a mistake in form? Did I do the right thing? Did I do the wrong thing? Just tell me what my next step is. Tell me what the guidance is. Tell me what to do. I have people that write to me, tell me what to do. Or they're so nervous and they're so anxious about making mistakes in form. There's so much intensity and guilt tied in there. And what Francis was sharing on Friday night was basically, you need to relax. You need to relax. You know, this intensity that you're feeling about right and wrong in terms of the world is just a distraction to keep you from relaxing. And you're not going to really be able to tune into the Holy Spirit if you're in a state of fear or anxiety. That blocks the Holy Spirit's voice from awareness. You have to begin to relax. And how can you relax any better than by admitting you have a perceptual problem? That is going to be the key to allow you to start to relax, to stop judging yourself. Right, wrong, positive, negative, oh my gosh, that self-judgment and self-criticism is depleting, it's depressing. It makes you tired, fatigued. It just is wearing your mind down because your mind wasn't created to be a judge. And so this judgment of the form, of judgment of the behavior, and judgment of the behaviors of others is very, very debilitating. And you know, also, if to judge is still denying that it's a perceptual problem. It's not bringing it back to your mind and saying, I am mistaken about everything I perceive. It's saying, no, I'm right about what I perceive. And I did these things right and wrong. And those people did these things right and wrong. And it's trying to be right about judgment instead of admit that I have a perceptual problem. It's so important to come to this admission of a perceptual problem.